Details are at kpfa.org/lsb.
And good afternoon. You're listening to 94.1 FM KPFA here in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's 1 p.m. Stand by.
Basin, from the magnificent redwoods of California to the icy majesty of the Arctic, life on Earth faces an unprecedented threat from careless development. Join Terra Verde over lunch today to find out about the unfolding future of the planet.
Welcome to Terra Verde, a weekly environmental radio show right here on KPFA or KPFB in Berkeley or KFCF in Fresno. My name is Pratap Chatterjee, and I'm glad to be back here after many years. Our topic today is offshore fracking, and the reason we want to talk about that is because a couple of weeks ago, news started to filter out that hydraulic fracturing, a controversial method for drilling for natural gas and also for oil, had been authorized a dozen times off the coast of California. Now, fracking's been in the news of late, partly because of three films, Gasland and its sequel, which is just out, as well as the Matt Damon film, Promised Land. And also because of, if you've been reading the news, the devastating impact of drilling on water quality in states, particularly like Pennsylvania and North Dakota, but actually now spreading around the country and indeed around the world, to places like South Africa, to Romania, and even to England. So joining me in the studio to discuss this are Jennifer Krill, who's the Executive Director of Earthworks, and Rose Braz of the Center for Biological Diversity. Joining us by phone from Southern California is Stephanie Sekich-Quinn of the Surfrider Foundation. Welcome, all of you, and thank you for joining me. Let's start with Jen. Welcome back to KPFA. Been on the show before, but never to talk about fracking. So tell our listeners how it works and what the environmental implications are.
Well, thanks so much for having me, Pratap. It's great to be here with you in the studio. So fracking is the process in which oil is extracted from what are called tight formations. Traditionally, what was known as easy oil was liquid pools under the ground, and you could drill down vertically, like a straw, into a soda and draw up the oil. Today, that easy oil is running out. So we've moved on to what we call unconventional or extreme sources like shale, which is when it has oil in it, it's a formation that has oil bound up in small bubbles. In order to get the oil out of shale, you need to fracture the rock. So in California, we have a formation called the Monterey Shale. It's under 8 counties, and it extends offshore. And in order to get to the Monterey Shale, we'll have to use these unconventional techniques like fracking, which is short for hydraulic fracturing, breaking up the rock in order to get the oil or gas out.
And how do we do this? If you're not drilling done horizontally, it sounds like there are other ways of doing it, such as going in another direction, going
right.
Horizontally, do you want to...
So you, instead of drilling, well, you can drill down vertically. So the technique of hydraulic fracturing is to pump millions of gallons of water laced with toxic chemicals into the formation to force it open. And then it also forces the oil and gas out of the wellbore. So
the water's going sort of sideways.
Well, that's a different part of the story. So you don't need to, like, traditionally, it's hard to call anything in this technology traditional, but they have been fracturing in California for decades by just fracturing those old vertical wells in order to enhance the oil production. With the Monterey Shale, we won't be able to just get the oil economically if we only use those vertical wells. So then they turn the drill sideways, and they can go horizontally a mile from the point of the wellbore, and then they fracture that horizontal wellbore, and you get, you know, a mile more exposure to the formation, so you get that much more oil and gas.
So, Rose, let's talk a bit about what's actually happening in California. Fracking is largely unregulated in this state, and the impact of fracking is not covered in the Safe Water Drinking Act, if I've got the name of the legislation correct. Tell us a bit about what the Center for Biological Diversity is doing about this and where you're getting. I understand you've brought a couple of lawsuits against the state, or...
We've sued the state and we've sued the federal government because you're absolutely correct that fracking has gone on in this state pretty much unregulated and unmonitored for many years. Up until just a couple of years ago, the state actually denied fracking was taking place. So we're coming to this a little bit later than places across the country. But come to find out, fracking is taking place. And this week, come to find out that fracking is also taking place offshore. And we know from these new reports that there are at least 12 occasions when fracking has taken place in federal waters offshore. And I think what's so concerning about this is,
When you say federal waters, what does that mean? Is that our laws here in California don't apply?
Not necessarily.
Okay.
Not necessarily. But the deficiencies of our state government in monitoring, regulating, overseeing fracking, unfortunately, often extend to our federal government, which has also done a really crappy job of monitoring what's going on, much less helping to prevent these harms. And we see cases of cover-ups, and we know what's happened in terms of Pavilion, Wyoming, where the EPA just recently, withdrew its investigation of water contamination there. So these same problems exist both federally and statewide. And what's come to learn this week is, at least on 12 occasions, fracking has taken place offshore. And, after the 1969 oil spill in Santa Barbara, Californians fought long and hard to put a moratorium on new oil and gas development and won that. And that's a huge deal. And I think as Californians, we often think, our offshore coastal waters are protected from oil and gas development. And the reality is that that deal grandfathered in a number of platforms, and those are the platforms, the existing platforms, existing leases that are now being fracked. And with new fracking technologies that Jen just outlined, what we're seeing, not only in the Monterey Shale onshore, but also potentially in the Monterey Shale offshore, is a dramatic potential for expansion of oil, specifically oil development in California and dirty oil development.
Let's bring Stephanie into this conversation. Stephanie Sekich-Quinn is with the Surfrider Foundation down in Southern California. And Surfrider, together with the Environmental Defense Center in Santa Barbara, have been working on the specific examples of this offshore fracking. So, Stephanie, tell us, where is it happening? It's happened a dozen times without pretty much anybody, presumably outside of the oil industry, knowing about this.
Correct. So it's kind of one of those books that we used to read when we were kids, you know, kind of choose your own adventure. And I feel like that's the course that's happened so far. In 2011, a few of us coastal advocates had suspected that offshore fracking had occurred. My good colleague Brian Segee from the Environmental Defense Center started doing what's called the Freedom of Information Act requests, where you get internal documents from government agencies. And one of the federal agencies, which we call BC, which is the Bureau of Safety and Environmental Enforcement, said, oh, actually, no, don't worry. It's only been done one time. And then after several more months of FOIA requests, come to find out, it's been about a dozen. And the majority of them have been done in the Santa Barbara Channel. So it's not all up and down the coast. It's in a very, you know, specific location. But what's extremely frustrating about it is that they were allowed to do this fracking under, quote-unquote, existing environmental permits without doing subsequent environmental analysis. And that just full stop, from our perspective, is illegal and unconscionable for them to just go ahead and proceed and kind of turn a blind eye to this. And what's really frustrating about what's happening on the federal side, and both of your guests have mentioned this, is that we won't know for years how much fracking has gone on until they go through all the documents, and many of them are not digitized. So they're going to have to go through physical documentation, and it could just take years to find out actually how much has really gone on here in the state.
So one question, because when people say offshore fracking, where is this actually happening? Is it happening 50 miles off the coast? Is it happening close to the coast? Is this something that would affect your members, the people who surf California's coastal waters?
Right. Well, as your previous guests have insinuated, it's taking place in federal waters. And so just to give your listeners a distinction on what that looks like, state waters are from basically the mean high tide or the coastal area to 3 miles out. And then federal waters begin 3 miles out further into the ocean. And so sometimes those platforms can be, as you mentioned, anywhere, you know, from 10 to 15 miles offshore. But as we know, the ocean really knows no boundaries between state and federal waters. And so, yeah, we're very concerned that some of these, you know, fluids could eventually make its way into state waters where our members are recreating and surfing. And I think, you know, just to really put a pinpoint on this is that as far as we can tell, really there's, you know, essentially 23, you know, platforms out there, and about half of them, you know, have done this kind of offshore fracking, and they're disposing directly into the ocean without any remediation. And so that's very alarming. And as we all know on this call, we don't know what those chemicals are. They're often proprietary. They often get pushed under, you know, exemptions from laws. And so we can't say what those chemicals would do. And so without baseline studies on how these chemicals interact with ocean ecosystems, I mean, surfriders calling for a full moratorium on any offshore fracking until we know what these chemicals are, how they interact with the environment, and have several independent scientific review studies.
Well, Jennifer, we actually do know a little bit about the chemicals. In fact, Earthworks has worked on this for many years, and there are, I don't know, something like 700 different chemicals, including known carcinogens. Do you want to tell us a little bit more about what we do know from onshore fracking as to the impact of these chemicals on human and the ecosystem?
Many companies voluntarily list the chemicals that they use for fracking on a proprietary corporate website called Frack Focus. They don't have to list there. There's no government requirement that the chemicals are listed. And in states that do have laws requiring chemical disclosure, companies have exemptions from disclosing those chemicals if they claim they're trade secrets. If disclosing the chemicals would harm their business prospects, then they don't have to list them. So we are very concerned. Stephanie's right. We don't know what the chemicals are. And since this is an offshore issue, the potential for disaster, if there is a minor problem, the potential for it escalating into a major disaster is much, much larger than it would be onshore. Like, all we have to do is look at the BP Deepwater Horizon story to know that in order to prevent a well blowout, in order to prevent a spill, you need to have some very serious protective measures and emergency response in place. And so far, these permits have been issued with none of the protective measures that we would expect to even minimally protect the environment of California.
Mm-hmm.
This is Prithip Chatterjee, and you're tuned to Terra Verde, a weekly environmental radio show right here on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley and KFCF in Fresno. You were just listening to Jennifer Krill, the executive director of Earthworks. And also in the studio with me is Rose Braz of the Center for Biological Diversity. Joining us by phone from Southern California is Stephanie Sakic-Quinn of the Surfrider Foundation. Rose, if we can go back to you, what is California, the state of California, what is Governor Jerry Brown doing about this? What is the EPA doing about it? These are the targets mm-hmm. of your lawsuits. Mm-hmm. Have they been trying to balance the needs of the environment, or have they been helping the oil and gas industry?
Mm-hmm. Well, so far, they've been unfortunately more on the side of the oil and gas industry, on the sides of communities impacted by fracking, or much less the ecosystems that are threatened by fracking. We're talking about offshore oil development. We do have several pieces of litigation pending. We actually just won a similar lawsuit against the Bureau of Land Management for leasing land in California, public land in California, for oil.
Near the Monterey Shale and some on the Monterey Shale
for leasing that land for oil and gas development without an environmental impact of the threats of fracking. And the court actually agreed with us in this litigation, and the result of that litigation is that the Bureau of Land Management has now suspended all new oil and gas development leases in California until at least the end of the year. They're doing that environmental analysis, and they are actually undertaking a statewide analysis of the impacts of oil and gas development and fracking statewide on public lands. This is the first such study that we know of in California, but it took litigation, unfortunately, to get there. And what we've seen on the state level is the state agency governing fracking has been completely asleep at the wheel, and is not regulating fracking, is not monitoring fracking, is not reporting when, requiring reporting when and where fracking is taking place, what chemicals are being used, what the concentration is of these chemicals. And what we are calling on Governor Jerry Brown to do is to place an immediate moratorium on fracking in this state. Ultimately, my organization believes that fracking is simply too risky for our air, our water, certainly our climate, and needs to be banned. But the very conservative approach actually would be, as Stephanie and Jen have pointed out, given how much we don't know about what's happening in California and how much we do know about what has happened across the country, the conservative approach for California would be for Governor Brown to place an immediate moratorium on both offshore and onshore fracking. And we think that actually would be the conservative, middle-of-the-road, safe way to go. But thus far, we haven't seen that happen.
Now, the EPA, the Environmental Protection Agency, has for several years now said that it is going to be releasing new studies on the impact of fracking. And they have been working with industry, trying to get access to the lands with some problems in terms of access to these lands, which seems a little strange. This is the government. They should be able to access these lands to do environmental studies. Where are we at with that? How helpful has the EPA been in terms of, we know industry is saying, you can't come on our land. I know, I think Range Resources in Texas was saying, well, we're sorry, we're not going to give you permission. So how has the EPA reacted? Has it been trying to force the industry to sit down and do something, or?
Well, recently we have become very concerned that the EPA is actually stepping back from its responsibility to protect the environment. In the case of fracking, there have been three high-profile studies initiated by the U.S. EPA, one in Dimmick, Pennsylvania, one in Parker County, Texas, the Range Resources case that you were talking about, and one in Pavilion, Wyoming. The EPA was bringing in scientists and tracking what had caused water contamination in these communities. And we're talking about the water wells of American citizens, people who live, who breathe, who pay their taxes, who have schools and kids and things that they care about in their communities. And the EPA has recently pulled back from all three studies. They sent the Wyoming study back to the state of Wyoming, which previously had refused to do the study in the first place. They dropped the Texas study, and they dropped the Dimmick, Pennsylvania study. So in the case of California here with offshore fracking, the EPA has stated that they don't believe that offshore fracking requires its own impact report, environmental impact report. And I would say that we should all be calling on the EPA to step up and protect the environment from this industry.
Stephanie, I want to bring you back here because I want to press in a point that I'd raised earlier, which is the offshore fracking taking place in federal waters. It's my understanding that, in fact, some of the fracking may take place a lot closer in coastal waters, particularly down at the Vandenberg Air Force Base, where, in fact, this would be within several hundred yards of the coast. Is that correct? Mm-hmm.
Well, and let's just back up here a second, because what I think is interesting is that the federal government just approved a new permit to a company called Decor, which is in the Santa Barbara and Ventura, to do fracking in the future. And in internal documents, Decor said to BSEE federal agencies that if we see this being successful, we will continue to pursue offshore fracking. And then as we dug through more internal documents and files from the federal government, other big oil industries have sent messages to BSEE saying the same thing, that if it proves to be economically viable and fruitful, we will also continue to pursue fracking. So that answers your question directly. The particular proposal that you mentioned at the Vandenberg base in Ventura is just getting off the ground. And so there's no specific plans. There's no, you know, aspects of wells that will be drilled and what those look like. They could be, you know, basically from onshore to offshore. But you see this culture starting to develop within big oil where they say, well, if it's good for this guy, it's going to be good for me. And so it gives us pause, Surfrider, to say, if there's drilling at the Vandenberg Airport base, which is onshore, and they decide to drill vertically offshore, who's to say that they won't use fracking? And because a lot of this information has been, quite frankly, secretive and non-transparent, we don't know what that looks like for that particular instance. So it's very alarming, and I really think it's fascinating for me as I go through these internal documents to see that we're not the only ones, Surfrider and Center for Biological Diversity and Earthworks, questioning the legality of fracking. There is an internal email from the chief of staff from BSEE, the federal agency, saying to one of his underlings, are you sure that we shouldn't be doing an environmental impact statement with these fracking issues? So they themselves know that they're sitting on the fence with legality, and we really want to raise that to the rest of the big oil industry that would like to do this offshore.
You know, Stephanie brings up a really important point here, the old wells versus the new wells. Industry, the oil and gas industry reports that 5% of wells that are drilled today, right now, new wells, will fail. That's a pretty high failure rate. I mean, I think if we got in our car and drove away today thinking that there was a 5% chance that we were going to crash, we'd think twice about driving. Within 15 years, 50% of well casings fail. For the old wells that we know are being fracked offshore in California, the 12 wells that were fracking jobs that were that surfaced with these FOIA requests, we're talking about fracking wells that were grandfathered in after a 1969 oil spill. If these are 40-year-old wells, they were not cased and they were not designed for fracking, which only increases the level of concern and scrutiny that the public needs to put on this issue. I'm very concerned that these well casings are not designed for what they're being used for right now.
And Jennifer, just to piggyback on that really quickly, you know, what's fascinating is when we're looking through these documents, these oil companies from Chevron to Venoco, who had done the fracking in those 12 instances, had to report on what happened as they fracked. And as far as I can tell, about three-fourths of the operations were not successful or were mildly successful. So Jennifer makes a great point. So we have these casings and these, you know, very aging, decrepit wells that are down there, and we continue to frack them. It's not even successful in the first place. And so those two issues really need to be pushed upon regulators as they go forth. And my question is if it hasn't been historically successful, then why are we continuing to experiment with offshore oil fracking?
Now, who are the companies that are doing this? There are a couple of names out there. One is Occidental, a company probably very familiar to listeners of this radio station, which is down in Southern California. Also, a couple of less well-known companies. Vanico, I think a couple of you mentioned Vanico. And I think there's another company called, is it PXP?
Yes.
Can you tell us a bit about these companies and their histories? Do any of you, I mean, again, they're not that. I see some blank looks here. well, we do know that Vanico, for example, is the company that has been applying for some of these permits. Is that correct?
That is correct. So in January 2013, this year, Vinico set off to improve production in one of its wells offshore, one of the old wells offshore that Jen has talked about. And the reports indicate from the FOIA request that they completed six different frack jobs. One thing that is important to know is a well can be fracked more than once. And in the reports, it's indicated that they injected about 300,000 pounds of fracking fluid mixed with sand and seawater 4,500 feet beneath the seabed. And they only mildly increased production. And additionally, this fracking spot was just 1,500 feet from a seismic fault. So all the concerns that we have around fracking onshore, we have additional concerns about fracking offshore in terms of the jumping of up to 80% of this fluid that goes down, comes back up. Where is it going? Into our oceans or into injection wells on surface, which have been connected with earthquakes. In our seismically active state, that's a big concern. So all of these concerns onshore. Additionally, we have additional concerns offshore.
Now, Jen, there have been earthquakes allegedly caused, in fact, maybe proven by fracking. In fact, there was, I think, a New Year's Eve incident a couple of years ago, or was it Christmas? Maybe about in Ohio, I think. Do you remember that?
Well, the greater causality that we found is what Rose is talking about, is not with the fracking itself. It's with the reinjection of chemicals, right, which is a way that toxic waste is disposed of in this country, not just fracking fluids, but toxic waste generally. With the boom in fracking, we're drilling 4,000 new wells across the country per month. 90% of them are fracked. The average frack well requires, to frack a job, you need something like 5 million gallons of water, some formations up to 13 million gallons of water, laced with toxic chemicals. That's a lot of waste. If 80% of that frack fluid comes back to the surface, that's a lot of waste. So the amount of reinjection of chemicals has increased so dramatically that now we are seeing swarms of earthquakes in places that you would never expect it. Ohio, Oklahoma, Arkansas, and that is a very real concern that California regulators are not addressing in our state at all.
We're going to have to leave it there, but I wanted to just thank each of you and give you an opportunity to give out a website for people to contact you or to learn more about the issue. So, Stephanie, why don't we start with you? How can people find out about Surfrider?
Well, thank you for having me on the show and raising this important issue. And Rose and Jen, keep up the great work. Our website is surfrider.org. That's SURFRIDER.org.
And Jennifer, let's go to you. Earthworks, how do you reach Earthworks? How do people find out more about fracking? You've got quite a lot of resources on your website.
We do. Earthworks has been working on extractive industries for 25 years, and you can learn more about our work at earthworksaction.org.
That's earthworksaction.org. And Rose, finally, the Center for Biological Diversity.
Our website is biologicaldiversity.org, and you can go to our Fractivist Toolbox. And also wanted to invite folks to join Californians Against Fracking, the statewide coalition to ban fracking, at californiansagainstfracking.org. Thanks.
And that's all the time we have. Thanks to each of you for being on the show. And each of the shows are available on kpfa.org for your convenience. Have a great weekend. Join us again over lunch between 1 and 2 in the afternoon on Fridays to hear more about the unfolding future of the planet.
We must hold CDCR, Department of Correction in California, the station, responsible for not only Weddell's death, but the death that came back in 2001, as well as future imminent death if CDCR does not meet its 5-court demand.
This Sunday, August 11th at 9 p.m., KPFA and BlackReportRadio.com will bring you exclusive coverage of the monumental California prison hunger strike. This will mark the 36th day of the hunger strike, which has already claimed one casualty at Corcoran State Prison, and at its high point had 30,000 prisoners participating across ethnic lines throughout the whole state. Tune in to learn more about the human rights abuses that go on every day in the California concentration camp system. I hope you will join me, your host, the People's Minister of Information, J.R. Valray, in this fight to get the government of California to negotiate with the prisoners instead of letting people die. Sunday, August 11th, 9 p.m.